Many centuries after my people had settled in different parts of the New World, the first white men arrived.
They were Norse sea rovers who landed somewhere on the North Atlantic coast. The Indians, called Skrullings by the Vikings, tried to drive them away, but were forced back into the forest. After wintering in a place they named Vinland, the Norsemen sailed away with a cargo of furs. Other Viking expeditions followed, but the few colonies they established were eventually abandoned. 500 years later, the well-known voyage of Columbus gave Spain possession of the land we call ours. Before long, Spanish soldiers arrived in Florida, bearing steel weapons and riding strange animals we had never seen before. Sometimes our people supplied them with food and acted as guides. But others fought fiercely to protect their homes, and entire villages were wiped out. Hernan Cortes, an ambitious young conquistador, landed on the coast of Mexico without opposition. He purposely had some of his ships run aground so his men could not desert his expedition. When news reached the Aztec emperor, Moctezuma, he sent messengers with lavish presents to induce the strangers to depart. But the gifts of gold only encouraged the Spaniards to invade the country. Cortes enlisted the aid of native groups who had been subjugated by the Aztecs. With these allies, he marched on Moctezuma's city. The Aztecs fought fiercely to repel the invaders. But after 3 months of battles and sieges, the city was taken and became the capital of what the Spaniards called New Spain. An expedition under Carnado was sent north into our southwest, seeking the goal of the legendary cities of Cibola. These proved to be poor villages on mesas, inhabited by Pueblo people, who resisted until they were conquered by firearms and steel lances. Disappointed, the Spaniards claimed the country for their king and moved on. In time, other Spaniards came and began to colonize. Santa Fe became the capital of the new territory, ruled from the palace of the governors. Dedicated priests taught the Indians their language and converted many of them to their religion. Missions were built with the help of native labor. These became places of refuge when the Apaches and Navajos raided the Pueblos. Cattle were imported by the Spanish settlers, and sheep were introduced. The ox carts were a source of wonder, for strangely enough, our people had never thought of the wheel. The trappings, which were later adopted by the cowboys, were brought in by the Spanish vaqueros. Some of the horses strayed from the corrals and soon multiplied in wild herds, running free across the vast terrain. Nomad Indians captured them and learned to ride. The Plains tribes built up large herds by stealing them. They soon became expert horsemen, hunting the buffalo on which their lives depended. Now they could travel far and wide, moving their lodges wherever they wished. Meanwhile, at Jamestown, on the Atlantic coast, the English had established a colony. Others, seeking religious freedom, arrived in New England and were welcomed by the local tribes. The Pilgrims could not have survived the first winter if Chief Massasoit had not fed and protected them. white settlers began clearing the land so that the game fled from our hunting grounds. This led to attacks on the settlements by our warriors, causing the settlers to band together, and over 400 Pequots were massacred, men, women, and children. King Philip, the son of the friendly Massasoit, led a war against the settlers, but his people were defeated and he was eventually murdered. However, other Englishmen, like the Quaker William Penn, acquired land by peaceful treaty. The Dutch had explored the Hudson River and purchased Manhattan Island for goods worth $24. Later, New Amsterdam was founded, but eventually was forced to surrender to the British and became New York. The French also claimed our land, exploring the St. Lawrence River and the Great Lakes, then descending the Mississippi all the way to the Gulf of Mexico. French missionaries labored in the wilderness to convert the Indians they encountered. On the whole, our people liked the French better than the English, for they respected our hunting grounds. French trappers traded guns and knives for our furs and often took Indian wives. When war broke out between England and France, all the eastern tribes joined the French as allies, except the Iroquois League, who were influenced by Joseph Brant, a Mohawk chief, to side with the British. Another great leader, Pontiac, united the Midwestern tribes to drive the English out, but the French were decisively defeated, and their Indian allies were forced to take refuge in Canada. Then the 13 colonies declared their independence from the British Crown, and George Washington was given command of the makeshift army. Among the leaders of the Iroquois League were Red Jacket and Corn Planter, who remained loyal to the British. 7 years later, the Revolutionary War ended with the Americans victorious. Once again, we had chosen the losing side. Now, despite treaties guaranteeing our rights, hordes of new settlers poured into the Ohio River Valley. The Shawnee leader, Tecumseh, with the aid of his brother called the Prophet, tried to unite the Midwest tribes to stop the white aggression. But his followers suffered a disastrous defeat at Tippecanoe, Indiana. A second war with England followed in 1812, and when the British were again beaten, the Cherokees were forcibly moved from their land into exile in the West. It was a Cherokee, Sequoia, who invented an alphabet for his people. In Illinois, Black Hawk of the Sac and Foxes made a valiant effort to save their homeland, but they too lost and were removed. In the South, the Seminoles on the Osceola refused to be conquered. Though he was captured through treachery, many of his people hid out in the Everglades and were never deported. For a long time, the tribes of the plains were left in peace because their land was considered to be worthless for settlement. Then war with Mexico resulted in the Americans taking over the entire Southwest and California, where many of our people had lived for countless centuries. The discovery of gold caused a rush of greedy adventurers to California. And wagon trains began rolling across the plain. Attacks by our warriors brought the United States Army into action, and we were forced to sign more treaties, which were later broken. To hold us in check, many forts were erected in areas important to our survival. Then a railroad was laid across the plain, and the Iron Horse brought in more and more settlers. Now, white hunters kill off great numbers of our buffalo merely for their hides. Wholesale destruction of our main source of food caused the Plains tribes to fight even more fiercely. In reprisal, Colonel George Custer led raids on even peaceful villages. Sitting Bull organized a large force of Sioux and Cheyenne to ride to attack the soldiers. They clashed at Little Bighorn. Custer and his troops fought against overwhelming odds. He and every one of his 224 men died. Kicking Bear, a Sioux warrior who was in the fight, painted the battle depicting Custer and his buckskin lying where he fell. This decisive engagement caused more troops to be sent. Eager for revenge, they slaughtered old men, women, and children at wounded knee. Chief Joseph led the Nez Perce towards Canada in a masterful retreat over the mountains, fighting delaying action all the way. But fresh troops cut him off a few miles from the border, and he was forced to surrender to save his people. Geronimo continued the warfare, leading the Chiricahua Apaches, but eventually he and his followers were captured and sent into captivity. Our people were herded into Indian territories where some of the eastern tribes had been moved. We were broken in spirit and starved until the government issued just enough rations to keep us alive. Even in Oklahoma, our last refuge, the land was open to white settlers and we were crowded into smaller reservations. We were now wards of the United States under the control of the Bureau of Indian Affairs with agents over us who were supposed to help us until we could find a way to be self-supporting. But many cheated. Our children were taken from us and sent away to boarding schools, but most of them were unable to become imitation whites and reverted to our old ways. On the reservations, we died of disease, malnutrition, and despair. Each year, the death rate was higher than the birth rate. We, the Native Americans, had reached the end of our trail. It was a dark hour for a proud race who once owned the continent.
At last, a government survey conditions was published, which aroused public indignation over the injustices we had suffered. Indians were made citizens, and some received land allotments for service in the First World War.
Although Indians were exempt from the draft, over 10,000 enlisted. Many more served with distinction in World War II, Korea, and Vietnam, and received the highest decorations for bravery. Nearly 80% were volunteers in all branches of the armed forces. The Signal Corps made special use of the Navajos to transmit messages in their own language, which enemy code experts were unable to break.
For many years, the Bureau of Indian Affairs had followed a paternal policy of supporting our people while keeping us on land held in trust by the Department of the Interior. However, it was not until 1934 that the Reorganization Act gave us the right to determine our self-government. The Bureau of Indian Affairs gradually discarded managing us and began to serve us.
Our native arts and crafts were revived.
Play! a change, we were now encouraged to keep our language, our customs, religion, and ceremonial.
And day schools were built so that children are no longer taken far from their homes. Educational programs, have been put into effect to teach useful trades. Mohawk steelworkers are employed on high construction jobs in many locations. We have had athletes like Jim Thorpe, one of the all-time greats, and among others, Six Killer of football fame. Our hospitals now have the most modern equipment, and Indian doctors and nurses have proved to be highly efficient. We are gradually becoming more and more self-supporting, given preference in position in the U.S. Indian Service. Some tribes have prospered by making use of their natural resources. Others have developed recreational centers to attract visitors. Some of our people, less fortunate in their surroundings, there is still much poverty. Unemployment is 10 times the national average. Tuberculosis, though declining, is nearly 6 times more prevalent among Indians than non-Indians. Alcoholism, though certainly not confined to our people, is a major problem. Suicide is another, especially among the young.
Changes have been slow in coming. There's still a long way to go, but the white man has shown he has a conscience. Our people are no longer doomed. We will survive, for we have regained our self-respect.